Good morning, Jai Shri Krishna. I don't think I announced this, but the 6th of June was a particularly sacred day. It was Akarya Ekadashi, or something that sounded like that. It was a big Ekadashi. People were fasting and people were getting triple benefits from chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Now, why am I bringing up the chanting? All of us know that we live in a limited existence. We have fragile bodies, we have very finite existences on the planet. And nothing could be more better expressed at a time of a pandemic. The fragility of the human condition, the angst and the helplessness that this pandemic brought about among all of us. So many of us were caught unawares. It was like having a Trojan horse in the country's backyard with this enemy, this virus creeping out of that Trojan horse overnight and making a complete breakdown happen in all that we considered to be good about life. Suddenly we had no oxygen, suddenly we had no beds. And so when you read Krishna's sacred narratives, like I'm now reading this book, it is called Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. What I derive from this is that he has provided the human race with enough chance, with enough wisdom, with enough protection. If they took action, they would not have had to see the worst of the pandemic. So we're going to get into that area today, that territory. How is it that we can protect ourselves, and what has Krishna provided us as protection? So I want to read out first a very, very powerful excerpt from this book that says that most of us are suicidal without realizing it. Okay? Simply because we have not been mindful that in the Kaliyug you really do need these layers of protection. The exact word used in Srimad Bhagavatam is Pashu Jnana, which means anybody who's sort of consuming meat, anybody who's kind of consuming life forms in a way that is very self-gratifying, they call them the Pashu Jnana. And that is why one of the things, and in fact scientifically it's been proven, that when your human system is not designed to digest meat. to an extent, perhaps we do end up digesting meat. At a younger age, the body can still handle it. But remember, non-vegetarian food remains in the body undigested for 3 full days. And that is work for the body to do. That is work that needs to be done, that detox. Okay, so he says that persons who are not self-realized and who are not interested in spiritual realization are killing themselves. They are committing suicide. Because this human form of life is especially meant for self-realization, by neglecting this important part of his activities, one simply wastes time like the animals. So you are in a human form which is a conscious form. And you are given a human life which is an intelligent, higher form of intelligence. And what he's saying is, I have equipped you to make choices. But are you making conscious choices? Or are you just living through sense gratification, distracted by the digital wave, distracted by content, distracted by your family life, your social life, your business? And not finding time to do what it is that you took this form to do, which is to evolve. So when you do that, when you're consumed with the world at the level of the animal, which is the 5 senses with survival, then you are a Pashu Jnana. The other meaning of the word refers to those who are actually killing animals, and this means persons who are animal eaters, dog eaters, for they are all engaged in killing animals in so many ways, such as hunting and opening slaughterhouses. Such persons cannot be interested in Krishna Katha. Now, a very interesting thing I discovered when I was reading through these pages is that even the simple act of listening to Krishna kathas, listening to Krishna's sacred epics, is itself a journey to liberation. And there have been historical kings who have chosen at their death, you know, and asked, like, they could barely, they're not eating, they're fasting to death, like one King Parikshit. King Parikshit was in the wife of Abhimanyu's womb, Abhimanyu's Arjuna's son. He died on the battle of the Kurukshetra field. And the wife was expecting Parikshit. And Krishna saw that there was a Brahmastra being dispatched to kill the baby in the woman's womb, the queen's womb. Krishna entered the queen's womb to protect this soul. And so when Parikshit was at the end of his journey, his life's journey, voluntarily seeking to die by fasting to death, all he wanted to hear were Krishna's leela, Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's stories, because he felt elevated into a transcendental state. Now, what is so special about Lord Krishna? He is an extremely unique figure, even if you put him in the context of incarnations. Not forget the mortal world and the limited world that we are in, but you put him in the context of even the divine hierarchy. What makes him so outstanding and so precious? So to begin with, when we use a Western term God, it doesn't really suit Krishna, because the Indian term Bhagavan actually stands for six unique and clearly defined qualities of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So God does not actually meet with that idea. So from now onwards, I will use the term Bhagwan when I refer to Shri Krishna. Now, the qualities that make him the unique Supreme Personality of Godhead: one, wealth; two, power; three, fame. Fame is automatically a part of Shri Krishna. Compare him to deities like, say, Brahma, Saraswati. You'll find the odd temple in Pushkar dedicated to Lord Brahma. But Krishna, his festivals, his Ekadashis, you know, his flute music, the chants, he's a very, very popular deity. Beauty. So Krishna, they call him Shyam Sundara, because he radiates charisma. And that charisma comes from a very unique constitutional quality to him, which I'll explain in a bit. Then he represents wisdom. So even if he's a baby, he's acting with wisdom. Even if his mother doesn't understand his stealing the butter and all these metaphorical and allegorical activities, one fine day he opens his mouth and what does she see? The entire cosmos is Krishna. So he is not stealing. He is merely settling some kind of karmic equations. And then, of course, from wisdom, there's also renunciation. So, you know, I, as a writer, I have interviewed people, as you know, from the film industry who enjoy power, fame, beauty, wealth, but very many of them are struggling with wisdom and are struggling with detachment. Because in Rahman's interview, now Rahman was spiritually working on himself a lot, and I think Rahman would approach these six qualities. I don't know about the beauty and all that, he doesn't care about that, but definitely he was a renunciate. All his Filmfare awards were piled up like trash on top of each other. And I saw zero ego association. So tomorrow, if Chennai had a little earthquake, those awards would all come tumbling down and it wouldn't bother him. So he was a renunciate, Rahman, and he ascribed everything to divine power. He didn't take credit. So again, he had overcome the ego. And he even shared this quote with me. He says, God, in the Sufi tradition, God says, those who I want to destroy, I make rich and famous. Because there is so much more responsibility that those people have to do good by humankind. And if they fail, they fall faster and they fall harder. So those who I want to destroy potentially, I make them rich and famous. So that's something to think about. So now Krishna existed 5,000 years ago and lived till the age of 125 earth years. In fact, I believe that when he was a charioteer and a counselor and a strategist at the Kurukshetra field during the Great War, he was actually in his hundreds somewhere like 100 and something years old and considered to be at his prime. So human life in a purer time was a much more expanded lifespan. And obviously because they were imbibing purer elements, the waters were clean, the air was clean, the ghee they ate was 100% natural ghee, the cows were not being given antibiotics and force-fed and force-milked. So everything about his time led to the human body surviving for 125 years. So I do think, though they say we are moving back towards a golden age, a Satya Yuga. So after the darkest age, which is the Kali Yuga, if we all start to pay attention to our consciousness and our choices, and a lot of that we already see happening, then the entire human race is eligible for a reboot and to begin again on a spiritual path and a spiritual vibration. So now we're going to look into a few aspects of the uniqueness of Krishna and how tuning into that can empower us and protect us. Now remember, in modern history, there are no historical records in Western systems that take you back more than 5,000 years. And anthropologists claim that 40,000 years ago, we as a species, we did not even exist. You had the caveman, but you had actually the ape man, and you had the ape. So they genuinely didn't think that there was any human history before 40,000 years. But lo, on the battlefield, when Arjuna was losing the plot and saying, how can I shed the blood of my own childhood playmates, my own cousins, my own guru, Dronacharya, my own uncles? How are you asking me to take a amoral sort of an action like that? So Krishna says, dear Arjuna, you and I have been incarnated 100,000 times. I have existed yuga yuga before this, so have you. But you belong to a limited time space quantum in your human body. I do not. And therefore, I assure you that all these souls around you are going to come back. They're not going anywhere permanently. They're not evolved enough, let's say, to disappear into, to get into dissolution and join the elements. They are all cyclical lives and they will all come back. And so he assures Arjuna that their kinship goes back lifetimes and lifetimes as well. This he says in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Then he also tells Arjuna, he says, look, we all have a mission, and your mission as a Kshatriya from the warrior caste is to protect Dharma and righteousness. And then he comes up with this very often quoted shloka from the Bhagavad Gita, which I'm going to recite for you, which is Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya ग्रानिर भवति भारत अभ्रुथानाम धर्मस्य तदात्मानं सृजाम्यहं परित्राणाय साधूना विनाशाय दुष्कृता धर्म संस्थापनाथाय संभवानि युगे युगे. So what he says essentially is, whenever adharma comes to the top, whenever there are discrepancies in the regulative principles of man's religious life and a prominence of irreligious activity and thought and word and deed, then I am compelled to appear on this earthly planet. Now, if you go to the Vishnu, the Dasha Avatar, so Krishna, of course, is a plenary he's sort of like a combination of all the different plenary versions of Lord Vishnu, which is why he is such a potent deity. Now, that's a very powerful incarnation. Imagine he has all the properties of the different Vishnus that exist. And the interesting thing is that at that time, when he took those birds, he had a clear mission to kill Kansa. Then later in that incarnation, he had a clear mission to restore Dharma, right? In Hastinapura, where there was a lot of injustice between the cousins. So what is the challenge with the Kali Yuga? Why don't you see a Krishna standing beside you or doing a little Rasleela dance with you? The challenge of the Kali Yuga is that each and every person is struggling with a weak value system. I will not judge people and say everybody is amoral, but certainly there is not that level of purity. Like the elements are a little polluted, everybody is subject to that little pollution. And they are also perhaps a bit low in religious endeavor. How many of us are doing a Mahayagna, purifying the space around us? How many of us are in touch with nature, with the elements, calling them to our help, calling all the smaller deities to come and live with us and rescue us? In the olden age, there wasn't that kind of a gap between, say, the Apsaras, the Gandharvas, and human beings. Apsaras were with rishis and they were having human being children, leaving those children, going back to the heavens. So there was much more interaction between the Devalok and the human world. And this is true across cultures, because I have a beautiful book that talks about this even in a Western context, that there were miraculous beings that walked the earth and walked among us. So now, when we're all in this low religious phase where we need to be constantly told to prioritize evolution, there is a solution that Krishna provides, and that is knowing which name to chant. And the big surprise when I was reading this, he doesn't say that my name alone will liberate you. In fact, he says there is a higher vibration in the name of Radhe. So there is a voice from Vrindavan, a viral video of a boy saying, quoting Krishna, but I'm translating, 1,000 names of Ramayana equals to one name of Ram. Three chants of Rama equals to one name Krishna. 100 Krishna, 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 Krishna equals to one Radhe. So if you start chanting Radhe, 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 you are multiplying by 100 the impact of Lord Sri Krishna's name. So if you want to invite grace, protection, financial protection, health protection for your family, then take the name of Radhe. Or if you're very attached to the name of Krishna, then you go Radhe, Radhe, Shyam Milade, Radhe, Radhe, Shyam Milade. And you know, I have to tell you a miracle story. When I was with my friend in Vrindavan during Diwali, so she cooked a massive big langar prasad that she wanted to distribute by hand to all the pilgrims that were making a parikrama of the Govardhan mountain at night. So in the boot of the van of her SUV, she had these huge vessels with food and these paper plates and spoons, and she scooped up a little, and I was passing it to all the pilgrims saying Radhe, 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 and all of them would respond with Shyam Milade, and they would take the prasad and then they would eat and then walk. When I came back, so many of the financial things that I was dealing with, so many like tax refunds and lots of things, automatically got sorted out. I got a call from my CA saying, it's done, you don't have to stress about all this work, it's done. And that is the power of course, giving, providing Annapurna. Annapurna is the goddess of food, and chanting the name of Radhe, Radhe. So what Krishna says is, there are three classes of men in this world. One consists of liberated souls, another consists of those trying to be liberated, and the third consists of materialistic men. Whether one is liberated or trying to be liberated, or is even grossly, heavily materialistic, the pastimes of Lord Krishna can set you free. And the pastimes have everything. They have dance, music, love, extramarital love. But it was not considered wrong, because love itself is such a pure, unconditional emotion. And that is part of my excerpt. So we don't want to be suicidal while we're alive. I think we should take a big hint from today's video and understand. He says, everyone is struggling hard for existence. In your time, life is also like the Kurukshetra battlefield. Okay? It is a vast ocean full of dangerous animals. Now, if Arjuna could conquer hugely empowered men like Bhishma, Drona, Karna, and many who are extraordinary warriors with many secret gifts. These warriors have actually been compared to the Timingala fish in the ocean. The Timingala fish can very easily swallow up massive whales. The great fighters on the battlefield could have swallowed many, many Arjunas very easily and many times over. But with Krishna on the chariot handling the reins, Arjuna single-handedly conquered all these giants. Just as one can cross with no exertion over the little bit of water contained in the hoof print of a calf, so Arjuna, by the grace of Krishna, was able to easily jump over the ocean of the battle of Kurukshetra. So let us put ourselves, close our eyes, put ourselves on a chariot. Imagine Krishna as your steerer, as the man you have given charge to for steering your life ahead. And see that all the enemies and all the challenges surrounding you are nothing but that little hoof print in the mud of the Kurukshetra battle, and you can easily cross over it because you have surrendered to the Lord Krishna. And the battlefield may soon turn into a garden. It may turn into a Shalimar full of blessings. There is nothing wrong with attempting this. So do please, let's end on that note. Radhe Radhe Shyam Vilas.